following mutation occurs here, most patients do die of their disease. Very few, about 17%, have learned that it's favorable risk outcomes due largely to chromosomal translocations, such as the T1517 in acute promyelocytic leukemia that predicts a good outcome based on current therapeutic interventions. So at the time, 2007, we knew very little about T-initiating mutations for AML patients. These intermediate-risk patients overwhelmingly had normal chromosomes, so if you looked at them under the microscope, there were not widespread aneuploidies, no indicators there, and very few deleterious somatic mutations. And ultimately, we really just were looking for prognostic markers, ways to stratify patients into better risk or poorer risk, so that we could then determine how aggressively to treat them or not. And in this effort, circa 2007, we essentially, as I said, made up a list of candidate genes, designed primers to amplify those out of AML genomes using PCR and compared to normal, and begin to look at mutations that were potentially causative in the disease. We only got so far with that before next-gen sequencing came along. And this, of course, was not immediately applicable to whole genome sequencing, but there weren't, at this point in time, good partitioning methods, such as the exome or panel hybrid capture that I'll talk about later. Instead, we really only had one option, which was to go after the whole genome. This was a fairly expensive proposition at the time, so pretty sort of dramatic task. First of all, we didn't know what the right coverage was. So how much did we need to oversample the genome to get coverage across all of the human chromosomes to the depth where we could identify mutations? Secondly, we didn't know what bioinformatics to use, so how best to compare tumors to normal once we actually had the data in hand, and so on. And so we took a fairly simple case here. This is an idealized case, a patient with highly diploid chromosomes, almost 100% tumor content in the bone marrow aspirate, as shown here on the H&E, that was taken as diagnosis from this patient. So we didn't really have to worry about contaminating normal signatures in the genome sequence. And we really, because this was such an adventurous project, went out to obtain philanthropic funding for the single patient genome, which we were fortunately able to do from a local donor, Al Zeitman, who also funds our NCI Comprehensive Cancer Center. And this is really the $1 million experiment. So the data generation alone for this patient cost on the order of about $1 million using current technologies at the time, selected sequencers that would only generate a billion base pairs per run. We calculated an average coverage that was needed of about 30-fold. That turned out to actually be about the right number. And from that initial study, we identified 10 genes with mutations, two which had been previously described in AML. So we weren't sure if 10 was the right number either, but now having sequenced through over 200 AMLs, as I'll talk about later, we now know that on average, AML patients across the spectrum from favorable to intermediate risk average 12 mutations in their genes, so we weren't too far off of the average at this point in time. Progressing forward then, using this whole genome sequencing paradigm, we developed a number of nuances that I'll tell you about, just in the context of one thing, which was verifying that our mutation calls were actually correct. So keep in mind that the bioinformatics, still whole genome sequencing, are a bit in development, although at that point in time they were entirely nascent. What we knew that we could do, especially once we got to the point of being able to do paradigm sequencing, which was not done on that original AML genome, is that we could sequence from the tumor about 50-fold, so oversampling was better for coverage and identifying mutations, sequence from the normal about 30-fold, and work through a series of algorithmic approaches to the data that are shown here in these different boxes once we aligned all of these read pairs to the human reference genome, tumor to normal, identify changes, and then compare one to the other to detect what's truly somatic. Beyond that, then we really developed some methods to double-check ourselves to make sure that we got it right the first time around. And that really went to designing custom capture probes that represented each variant site that we predicted in the genome, not just single nucleotide indels, but also, complex structural variants where we would literally pile probes through the variant region, hoping to capture that back out, resequence those, and double-check those on alignment to the genome, just to make sure tumors are normal, that we had the right variants that were identified. And iteratively, as we did this over and over again, we were able to now build filters into our calling pipelines to actually tease out known sources of false positivity. So we became much more precise in the process of doing this. The other thing we finally realized as we were going through this exercise was that these data were valuable for another reason, and that is to evaluate the heterogeneity, the cell-to-cell-based differences in cancer masses that occur by virtue of comparing deep sequencing data at all of these variant sites that were captured by hybridization. So I'll show you how this worked and then show you some examples from a single patient study. This is what we refer to as DDS, or deep digital sequencing. What you do is what I just described a minute ago, design custom capture probes for all of these sites in the genome that you think contain variants. You hybridize those to the tumor or normal genome that you've already sequenced through in the process of generating the data the first time around. And these hybridized fragments can be pulled down by virtue of the fact that the custom capture probes have biotins on them and can be captured out of solution using strepped-avid encoded magnetic beads. And once these are isolated away from the rest of the genome fragments, post-hybridization, these are readily eluted off and then amplified in sequence. So you can essentially just recreate very high isolated regions of the genome that you're interested in evaluating a second time for variants. So because of the high depth that is generated on these, and because of the nature of next-gen sequencing being very digital, each read on the sequencer essentially represents a single fragment from the library that you sequenced, we can now go about estimating heterogeneity for any population of sample, any population of tumor cells that have contributed DNA into a sample. So the way this works is that you generate this high depth coverage that I've already shown, and by virtue of aligning back to the genome, you now have a digital readout of each of the two alleles that are present in the population of fragments. So each mutation will show up typically as a mixture of wild-type and mutated reads, because most regions that we identify are in fact heterozygous mutations, although not all. And then you sort of begin to look at counting the digital representation of each variant, where by inference, the older mutations that are present in every cell, basically the founder clone that went on to form that tumor, are present at very high variant allele frequency. So for heterozygous mutations, this approximates 50% of the reads being represented carrying the variant. Whereas any newer mutation in the tumor cell population will be present but at a lower variant allele fraction, and so fewer reads in that population of captured fragments will represent the variant. We can then use some statistical Bayesian methods to essentially model tumor heterogeneity by grouping together variants that share the same approximate variant allele fraction, and then build a model of the clonality or heterogeneity of that tumor. And I would argue that, as I'll show, just looking at a single tumor in isolation in terms of heterogeneity, kind of interesting. Actually looking at the changes in heterogeneity or clonality over a natural history of that tumor, much more interesting. So what is the impact of therapy, for example, on the changes between primary disease and non-treated disease, for example, or the primary versus the metastatic setting? So I'll show you some examples of that from our work with AML. I'll show it in a couple of ways. Graphically, we'll sort of look at comparison of the variant allele fractions between genomes, where in this particular toy example, I'm looking at tumor 1, that could be the primary presentation, and tumor 2 could be the relapse, for example. And graphically, this is the founder clone that I've just described. So those set of mutations that are present from the beginning of the tumor's occurrence towards progression and are shared by every cell in the tumor. Anything that's new, for example, in the relapse or metastatic setting would group closer to this axis, and anything that gets left behind by virtue of the therapeutic intervention would group closer to the tumor 1 unique axis. So this is the toy example, and we'll see how that plays out in real samples in a minute. The other way to illustrate this for those of you who are graphically oriented, and many people are, because this is a figure from a Nature paper that has been used not by just me and my colleagues, but many people over time, and replicated in other papers by other groups to really illustrate the progression of a tumor throughout evolution, which is really truly an evolutionary process. So in this particular example, which is from this study in Nature 2012 of the 8 primary tumor relapse samples in AML, what we're able to identify for this patient, again, the first patient that we ever sequenced in that Nature paper from 2008, by studying her relapse disease and very high coverage her tumor in the primary treatment naive setting, we identified that this patient expanded one of her hematopoietic stem cells by virtue of a suite of founder clone mutations that are listed here, DNMT3A, NPM1, FLT3, and TPPRC, and these flourish in the bone marrow to create 4 different subclones that are present in different proportions. The highest one at 53%, it has its own unique genotype on top of the founder clone, and these other 3 minor subclones that also have their own unique genotype on top of the founder clone. You can now see the incredible evolutionary pressure that's put on this genome by virtue of the chemotherapeutic intervention that's used to try and get this patient into remission, and only by sequencing the relapse clone do we identify the fact that this minor subclone, present at about 5% of the primary disease, acquires additional mutations, a translocation that fuses 2 genes together, and now flourishes as the sole population in this patient's relapse sample. So it's related to the primary, but it's a minor subclone, and we saw this in multiple patients in the study, where we were still at that point fairly nascent in our ability to sequence deeply, and so many of these patients appear to be monoclonal, but actually probably had very minor subclones that we just could not detect. So let's dig deep into one of these patients that was originally presented into the study, and I'll show you sort of the natural history of the disease, focusing on this one patient. This is a patient AML31. You can see a fairly typical presentation in AML, the 3-gen regimen, achieved clinical remission from this regimen, but relapsed after 16 months' time. And of course, the beauty of studying AML is that the clinical protocols, the standard of care, permit bone marrow aspirates to be taken at different time points in the disease. And if you have the banking protocol, you can save these over time and go back, as I'll show you, to investigate the natural history of each patient's disease. So in this initial Nature paper, we just did fairly standard low coverage. The genome sequencing at the whole genome scale was still pretty expensive in 2012, so we studied the normal tumor and the relapse disease, and then went for high coverage capture validation that I just described for you, and we were able to sort of put together this particular diagram of this patient's cancer evolution. So the primary disease here with 3 subclones, a founder clone and 2 minor subclones, and then the recurrent disease with just a single, relapse genotype present. We then sort of put this particular patient's cancer genome on steroids, if you will, in this paper that just came out in 2015 in Cell Systems. I think this was actually the first issue of this journal. And this is the sort of graphical abstract. And you can see here that what we've done now is we've gone well beyond the sort of standard 50-30 full coverage that I described for you earlier to address a number of questions, which I'll walk you through fairly quickly because this is already published. So you can now see that we really kind of went a little bit crazy on this in terms of high depth coverage full genome, exome, this deep capture validation that I told you about already, targeted sequencing using 250 recurrently mutated genes in AML, more on that later, digital droplet PCR, lots of RNA-seq data, et cetera. What did we learn from this study? Well, first of all, we learned a lot about different short realigners and different variant colors, and we learned about what we could find from orthogonal validation data, including digital droplet PCR compared here to sequencing during allele fraction, pretty good concordance, ion torrent data versus Illumina-based capture data, not so great concordance, and interestingly, and I'll get back to this at the end of the talk, the correlation between DNA variant allele fraction and RNA variant allele fraction, which interestingly, even for a case like AML, where there are very few mutations that are actually identified, some of these mutations clearly are not expressed at the level of RNA. More on that later when I get to melanoma. Coverage depth definitely matters. Can we afford to sequence every tumor to 300 full coverage? No, we cannot. And even in the $1,000 genome era, we really can't afford to do that. But I think you can readily appreciate, moving from panel A to panel F here, the impact that additional coverage has on really tightening our understanding of clonality in the disease, where different clonal populations become much more evident as we pile on coverage for this particular tumor sample. And here's sort of the final delineation through our Bayesian mixture modeling algorithm called Cyclone, where interestingly, our platinum call set, so highly validated mutations through all of these different exercises that I just showed you, turns out to be on the order of about 1,300 point mutations, single nucleotide variants, genome-wide, compared to only 119 that were originally identified from the 30 fold coverage of the genome. And again, you can see beautiful examples of known driver mutations such as FLT3IDH1 clearly dropping out in subclones that are defeated by the induction chemotherapy in the primary disease, and new ones that are occurring, interestingly, now in this subclone that's unique to the relapse, an IDH2 mutation in the hotspot location. So lots of interesting vignettes here, and of course, number one, as I'll just point out to the obvious, is the founder clone, which persists in both presentations of the disease. Now, our topical fish plot looks a lot more complicated and representative of the heterogeneity here at day 0 when the patient is diagnosed, and at the recurrent sample here in 500 days down the line, and you can see that we've now identified key new mutations in all of these different subclones. Back to the bank samples that we had in the freezer at different time points from the initial diagnosis all the way to this relapse diagnosis that I've already told you about. And through high-depth sequencing using digital droplet PCR looking just at specific mutations, you can sort of see the ebb and flow, but never the complete diminution of a mutational signature in this patient. In other words, high-depth sequencing of this type can actually give us a clue about whether patients are indeed in remission or just have some occult disease that can't be detected by commonly used pathology methods. The other interesting vignette in this patient's genome reflects something that's now sort of widely appreciated, and that is that patients even without leukemia can develop hematopoietic stem cell expansion. So they acquire just a single mutation that's a growth advantage, if you will, for that hematopoietic stem cell. And even though they're still completely healthy, every one of their developed blood cells reflects the genotype of the single hematopoietic stem cell. Example, in this particular patient, this was a P53 mutation that was acquired, and you can see better is this sort of bright blue subclone. This is a hematopoietic stem cell expansion that occurs while the patient is in remission, or apparently so. It's not cancer because it's completely unrelated to the genome of the cancer. So you can see these are originating from 2 completely different HSCs over here. And this expansion phenomenon essentially goes away when the patient recurs with the relapse disease at day 505. So just to finish up with this particular vignette, we've now completed a number of samples in the third iteration of their tumor. So once these patients relapse in the disease for the very first time, they go through induction chemotherapy to remission and receive a stem cell transplant, a so-called allogeneic stem cell transplant from a related donor if one exists. Many of these patients will go on to develop AML a third time.
Histology. And then down here in the alveoli, as I said, there were the type 2 cells and the type 1 cells. So this is just a summary.
summarizing a little bit about what we know at present about these stem cell populations. And I will say that it's quite a complicated story, because in steady state in the lung, there's rather little cell turnover. And only one can really see what the potential of these cell types is to do various injury and infection.